Well, he's the only person to have climbed Mount Everest and crossed Arabia's empty quarter on foot and by camel. Jamie Clarke has co-produced documentary films and co-authored books based on his expeditions. Clarke was recently in the Valley to address environmental public interest group Valley Forward Association at its annual luncheon. He spoke with Merry Lucero about his challenges and how he hopes others will engage in their own adventures and apply them to everyday living.
Jamie Clarke, thanks so much for sitting down and talking with me. First of all, what was it like to climb Mount Everest?
I believe that day was one for which I was born on a lot of levels. On the summit itself, I had tried twice before and failed both times, coming very close. So it was a long process to get there. I was a little kid with a dream and off we went. And so to have this moment all these years later to realize the dream, for me there was a great sense of peace, that here you are on the smallest of patches of snow that marks the top of the world, and this dream is realized, and I was just flooded with a sense of peacefulness. Plus fear. I had a long way to go to get back, but predominantly peace, and I still carry that with me today.
So you get to the top of Mount Everest, and you have this peace and this, you know, epiphany, and then you go, okay, now where am I going to go?
Right. Yeah, that was the second most asked question anytime I complete an adventure is, what's next? And so even not long after the summit of Everest, I was already contemplating, well, would it be another mountain? But I was more interested in a more diverse environment. I wanted something not only geographically in a contrast to Everest, but something culturally different. And I had spent time in the deserts of Arabia and in Africa, and I decided I was frankly sick and tired of being cold and vertical, and I figured it was time for something flat and hot.
And dry.
And dry, yeah. And so off we went. To cross Arabia's empty quarter, the Rub al Khali, the world's largest proper sand desert, on foot and by camel.
Why did you do it that way and not with all the modern technology that was available?
We wanted to have the adventure across the empty quarter as one that was as close to what the traditional mode of transport was through the region. So there was this idealistic notion that we would go and have this journey like the first who had journeyed across the region. On top of that, though, there was some practicality to it. You couldn't employ much of today's technology to get across that desert, such as four-wheel drive vehicles, Hummers or something. You could skirt the heart of the desert, but the Uruk al-Sheba and the Umasamim, it's a very strange and bizarre region right in the middle of the desert, monstrous dunes 3,000 feet high, and snaking beneath their valley and the valley floor are these regions of quicksand, the crusts of salt and sand and these mud flats. To drive across there in a vehicle is impossible, and we wanted to cross the heart of the desert. And the only way to do that is on foot, and you need some sort of animal to help you get across. Horses obviously wouldn't be able to endure that heat or the length of the days without food and resupply. And the only creature evolved and adapted to that sort of travel is the camel.
Your greatest hardship and your best triumph in that journey.
The desert beat me into the ground in a way that I thought I had respected, but I didn't really understand until we were there. And it was more of an emotional pounding than it was necessarily the physical challenge. It was just being hungry, and more profoundly being thirsty every day, stuck in the heat, 125, 126 degrees. You know, your viewers can appreciate that sort of temperature. No air conditioning to escape to, no shade to be found. 18 hours a day underfoot, albeit on the camels at times. And there was no distraction. On Everest, there was always the drama of a risk, of a potential fall. Around every corner, a new vista, with every rise in elevation, something new to see. The desert was monotonous and flat, and it beat me up, and there was no distraction. And I basically, it was like a great mirror lifted out of the sand to reflect the raw reality of who I am, and I realized I didn't really like that person I bumped into out there. And so to have to face that and to somehow get past it was, without, you know, sounding hokey, was by far the most humbling portion of that journey and, in the end, the greatest reward.
Did you come here to do some training?
Spent a lot of time in Arizona. I love Arizona. My favorite thing to do when I'm in town, if I'm here on business, is to run Camelback Mountain. And I would do it in the summer. So I would try to train my body to deal with the heat. So normally I would be here in January or February, but then over time I creep closer and closer and closer and closer and closer to the summer. And I did it one time in July, up and over and back again. I had some rough hours afterward. I was just laying in my cold bathtub back at the hotel room, thinking, man, Everest is a lot easier. So I spent a lot of time just doing physical activity in the desert, learning about desert travel, about desert navigation. This environment in Arizona, to me, the beauty of it, the smell of it, is very reminiscent, although the vegetation is dramatically different, very reminiscent of the empty quarter of Arabia, and I loved coming here.
You're here talking to Valley Forward Association. What do you bring to them, this group who's focused on the environment?
What I guess I bring is someone who has a love of all sorts of environments around the world and has basically dedicated my life to the largely human-powered travel through them. And I guess ultimately the idea of how we interact and live in our environment is something that's particularly of interest to me. Harsh as it may be at times, how can we embrace it more than trying to wall ourselves up from it? And I think Valley Forward Association is a lot about embracing the beauty of the environment and incorporating it into our life rather than trying to create walls to separate us.
Is one of your goals in writing Everest to Arabia to get people thinking about adventures, however large and small, that they've had in their past, and remember those and apply them to their lives?
Well, you've said that better than I could have imagined. Yeah, that's not just the goal of that book, but the goal of pretty much everything that I put out, whether it's the talks I give, like I'll give the Valley Forward Association, whether it's the books I've written or the films I might make. Inside of all of the entertainment and the stories, I want to do exactly what you said. I want to inspire people to live an adventurous life on their own terms. And I don't think it requires grandiose adventures like crossing the Arabia on camel or climbing Mount Everest, take thousands of dollars, years of effort, years of training and preparation. It doesn't require that. I think you can have adventures on the Camelback Mountain on the Saturday morning. So it's July and it's hot. Well, get up at 4:30 and go hike up it. And my belief is that a life, among many other things, well-lived is one rich in experience. And experience comes when we're willing to engage. And ultimately, that's all I'm hoping for, is that people will engage in their lives. Small things, if you do them consistently, they add up into great big things. And that's really at the heart of what I believe in. And from an environmental perspective, without waving the flag and getting on a soapbox, because I think the message is lost when you're trying to jam preach to people, I believe if they're hiking Camelback Mountain, then they are concerned about its preservation. How are the trails maintained? What are we going to do with parking? How's it taken care of? Because it's a place that I travel in. I have memories there. So I want people to get out into the environment, go to the national parks, get up to Sedona, walk around this beautiful place to see it and care about it. And the more people are out engaging in the environment, naturally the more they're going to care about the environment. And as a result, we're going to not feel badly about paying taxes to take care of it. We're going to lobby our politicians and elect those who we believe will take care of it with us. And that, to me, is the mission.
Jamie Clarke, thanks so much for sitting down and talking with me. And good luck on your next adventure.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm off to Indonesia to climb a big peak in the jungle. Should be fun in a sick, twisted sort of way.